Good evening. I would like to ask everyone to take a seat. Welcome in Bali. My name is Özkan Gülpınar. I've got the privilege to moderate tonight's program, The Art of Remembrance, 100 Years Armenian Genocide. A special welcome also to the Armenian ambassador in the Netherlands. Welcome. Tonight will be a collaboration between the Holland Festival and the Bali, with a focus on the rich musical culture and traditions of the East. That's the topic of Holland Festival's event. And what we have seen in the last few weeks is a mix between the Sufi music of Al-Kindi, Mercan Dede, Kardeş Türküleri, to the music of Armenian composer Gurdjieff. And therefore, Holland Festival has invited a lot of musicians and composers from Turkey and Armenia to introduce their music to the Dutch audience. Can everybody hear me? I've got the feeling that, yeah? Okay, that's good. One of the composers is among us today, Levon Eskenian. He is here and he will also play some of his music for us tonight. To give the audience a glimpse into the complex history and culture from that region, the Bali has organized two context programs. Tonight is the second part. Last week was the first part of these talks in which we focus on the culture in that region. And tonight will be on the culture and history of Armenia, a culture that is marked by the tragic history of the Armenian genocide that took place 100 years ago. This evening we will talk about art in relation to the history, but moreover we will talk about how this history has marked and influenced contemporary artists from Armenian descent. We will talk about their artistic work, be it music, poetry, film or visual art. I will later on introduce them one by one to you. Before I do that, I would like to point out that tonight is also a special event for me. 12 years ago, my own first theater piece was performed here, and it dealt exactly with some topics of remembrance. It dealt with the issue of loss of part of my history. And that was my first encounter here in the Bali. The Bali was the first place who gave this opportunity to perform here. So for me, it's also nice to be here among such lovely people who will share their ideas and visions with us. I'm really happy that you're here. Before we do that, we will have an introduction by Dr. Ton Zwaan, who is Emeritus Professor, Genocide Studies and Anthropology at the University of Amsterdam and a researcher at the NIOD, the Institute for War, Holocaust and Genocide Studies. Dr. Ton Zwaan has published and lectured many times on this topic of genocide, and he is willing to share with us also his ideas on the topic. It will be short, it will be a short introduction. Tonight is about the way artists deal with their remembrance, but first we will have the introduction by Dr. Ton Zwaan. I would like to invite you to start with your introduction lecture. Thank you.
Well, good evening to you all. This evening is devoted to art and remembrance. And three artists with an Armenian background will present you various forms of art which are partly influenced by the memory of the tragic history of the Armenian people in the late 19th and early 20th century. As many, or at least some of you, may not be familiar with that history, the organizers of this evening have asked me to deliver a very short historical introduction. In my speech, I will try to answer, in a nutshell, of course, three questions. First, what happened to the Ottoman Armenian population during the decline and fall of the Ottoman Turkish Empire? Secondly, how did that happen? And lastly, why did that happen? At the eve of the First World War in the summer of 1914, there were about 2 million Christian Armenians in the largely Muslim Ottoman Empire, more than half of them living in the eastern part of Anatolia. Other groups lived dispersed over the whole territory of the empire. Roughly another 1 million Armenians were living at the time in the Tsarist Russian Empire, many of them just over the border in Transcaucasia and the Caucasus, largely in the region which today forms the Republic of Armenia. Together, these areas formed the homelands of the Armenian people for many centuries. A relatively small nation squeezed between two vast and powerful empires. At the end of the World War in 1919, of the 2 million Ottoman Armenians, an estimated 120,000 to 150,000 were still living there. The overwhelming majority had vanished. What happened to these people? The answer to that question is threefold. Firstly, more than half of them, probably more than 1 million people, had fallen victim to a centrally organized and systematic process of persecution and destruction, mainly during 1915 and 1916. Contemporary sources, eyewitness accounts, and also reports in the world press speak of, and I quote, the massacre or the murder of a people, of a nation, or a race, and of the complete annihilation or destruction of the Armenian population in the Ottoman Empire. About how this happened, I will tell you a bit more in a few minutes, but let us first look at the other two parts of the answer. Secondly, then, under pressure of the mounting threats and also the mounting violence against them, several hundred thousand of Armenians succeeded in escaping to neighboring countries, especially Russia and Iran, or Persia as it was then called, also to Greece and Bulgaria, and also to further destinations in Egypt, in Europe, France especially, and lastly in the United States. They were never to return to where they came from. Large parts of the worldwide Armenian diaspora population of today stem from these refugees of 100 years ago. Certainly, far smaller groups of Ottoman Armenians, maybe several tens of thousands, and mainly women, young girls and children, were able to save their lives by converting to Islam. Most of these conversions were forced conversions. They took place under the threat of lethal violence. Over the past few decades, quite some cases have come to light in Turkey, and the whole issue, whereby some Turkish people have discovered that they had a secretly Armenian grandmother, have been hotly discussed in public there. Understandably, the horrible legacy of these years has deeply influenced the collective identity of many Armenians in subsequent generations. As a people, they had been targeted for extinction. Enormous numbers had been deported and killed. Survivors and relatives had to live on with shocking memories of the atrocities which had taken place. Other great numbers had fled or been driven from their ancestral homelands, never to return. Moreover, they had lost nearly all their property, their houses, farms, cattle and land, their workshops and industries. All their material possessions were confiscated by the state or stolen and robbed by powerful others on the local level. No restitution nor compensation was ever offered to them. Furthermore, over the next decades, a concerted effort was made to wipe out all traces of Armenian culture in the Ottoman lands, and to cap it all, next to no one was ever brought to justice for the colossal crimes. It all happened with nearly complete impunity. And from 1923 on until the present day, the newly formed Republic of Turkey has pursued an official and active policy of denial. Seeing all this, it's not amazing that even after 100 years and 4 to 5 generations, today many Armenians still are painfully aware of the catastrophe of 1915 and the bitter fate of preceding generations. How did this all happen? Just before the beginning of the First World War, Ottoman Turkey fought and largely lost 2 short wars, the so-called Balkan Wars in 1912 and 1913. Confronted by the combined military forces of Serbia, Greece and Bulgaria, with Montenegro in the background, the Empire lost nearly all its remaining territories, territorial possessions in the Balkans, like Kosovo, Macedonia, northern Greece and parts of Albania. Tens of thousands of Ottoman soldiers lost their lives, and hundreds of thousands of Muslim refugees, the so-called Muhajirs, fled to Anatolia. With other Muslim refugees from the Caucasus, who had fled from Russian rule, in 1914 they possibly numbered around 1 million people, mostly poor and destitute, and searching for a new existence. Amid this turmoil, in January 1913, a small faction of radical Turkish nationalist political and military leaders had taken over, by a bloody coup d'etat, the central state power in Istanbul. They declared a state of siege. They suspended the Ottoman parliament. They curtailed civil rights and effectively turned the empire into a dictatorship. This small elite stemmed from the larger political movement for union and progress, İttihat ve Terakki in Turkish, in the West, better known as so-called Young Turks, which had successfully staged in 1908 a revolution against the rule of the Sultan and his government. These new rulers who came to power in 1913 had a strongly military mentality and an ethnic nationalist dream. They wanted a Turkey for the Turks, and they harbored deep suspicions about the great European powers, especially Russia, and the remaining sizable Christian minorities in Anatolia, the Greeks and the Armenians. Hardly a year later, they allied themselves with Germany and Austria-Hungary in the hope of preventing international isolation, and with the military might of these two powers to win back lost territories in the Balkans and elsewhere. In the fall of 1914, the rather feeble Ottoman Empire was at war with Russia, France, and Great Britain. The first military events of the war went bad for Turkey. Russian troops invaded the northeastern part of Anatolia. A strong British Indian force landed in southern Iraq, then an Ottoman province, occupied Basra, and proceeded to march on Baghdad. A Turkish campaign from Palestine, another Ottoman province, against the British in Egypt misfired completely. But the most devastating military setback happened in the winter of 1914-15 in the mountainous area around Sarakamish, not far from the northeastern city of Kars. An Ottoman campaign under the command of General Enver Pasha, also Minister of Defense and one of the strong men of the radical regime, aimed at pushing back the invading Russians, but it failed miserably. Due to superior Russian military tactics and under extremely bad weather conditions with freezing temperatures and heavy snowstorms, an Ottoman army of about 120,000 troops was nearly wiped out. Within 2 weeks, around 80,000 Ottoman soldiers were killed, wounded, or simply froze to death. It is highly likely that shortly after this devastating blow, the central Turkish leadership decided to launch a campaign of persecution and destruction against the Armenian population. Although no evidence was ever produced, there were strong rumors and suspicions that the military defeat had been caused by treason of Ottoman Armenian military units who were accused of having made common cause with the Russian enemy. The anti-Armenian campaign which followed went through three stages. Firstly, in the months of February and March 1915, Armenian officers and soldiers in the Ottoman army, probably more than 100,000, were disarmed, fired from the ranks, arrested, and forced into so-called labor battalions. They had to perform hard military labor under dire circumstances. Scores of them died from sheer exhaustion, while other groups were summarily executed. During these same months, Armenian villages and neighborhoods in small cities in the eastern provinces were incidentally attacked by Turkish army units and paramilitary groups of Kurdish mounted warriors. Sometimes also, Armenians successfully resisted and fought back for some time, but most often they were outnumbered. Here and there also, Armenians were uprooted and whole villages were forcefully deported to other areas in the interior of Anatolia. And then the second stage came. In late April, hundreds of prominent and leading Armenians, the majority of the Armenian elite, was suddenly arrested in Istanbul and other cities. Through carefully coordinated action by the Ministry of the Interior and the police, they were deported by train to outlying places, and after some weeks, nearly all of them were killed, often after the most horrible torture. This development coincided more or less with the Allied maritime attack on the straits and the landings at the peninsula of Gallipoli, not far from Istanbul. With great numbers of Armenian males, officers and soldiers already out of the way, and with most leading Armenians imprisoned or killed, the regime had considerably reduced the risks of effective Armenian resistance. And now the search stage unfolded. From May and June on, in the eastern provinces, but also everywhere else in the empire, with the partial exception of Istanbul and Izmir, or Smyrna, as it was then called, the total Armenian population was forcefully uprooted and deported. The central regime proclaimed two decrees or laws. According to the first one, all Armenians were to be relocated, as it was officially called, to the southern Ottoman provinces, present-day Syria and Iraq. According to the second law, they had to leave behind nearly all their positions, which would be taken care of the authorities and effectively confiscated. Later on, many Armenian villages and properties were distributed to the Muhajirs, the poor Muslim refugees who lived in Anatolia. Although the subsequent events varied from place to place depending on specific local and regional circumstances, overall the Armenians were called up and rounded up by Turkish rural police forces and soldiers, and within days set on their way on foot in great deportation trains. Very often, the remaining males were led away first and killed by their guards not far from where they left. The rest of the population, all the people, women and children, then started their journey a bit later. The distances were enormous, often many hundreds of miles through difficult mountainous terrain. Food and drink quickly became very scarce. There were next to no provisions made for the masses of deportees. They were also often robbed, raped, and attacked by their guards, or ambushed by Kurdish troops, local bandits, or members of the so-called special organization, the Teşkilat I Masusiye, around 30,000 strong, with the special purpose of destroying the Armenians. During the summer and fall of 1915, Eastern Anatolia became a virtual slaughterhouse. It has been estimated that after months, less than half of all the deportees reached their destinations in the deserts of northern Syria and Iraq. Some escaped and survived. Many others were starved to death, or even killed in large massacres in late 1915, early 1916, near places which we know today from IS, places like Raqqa, Deir ez-Zor, Aleppo, and other places. Now we have seen, in a nutshell, what happened and how it happened. I will be very short on the question why it happened. Although the concept of genocide did not yet exist at the time, it was coined for the first time in 1944, we are clearly confronted with a genocidal process. A small dictatorial elite could dispose of the vast state power resources of the Ottoman Empire. That's the first point. Secondly, they were under the spell of an extreme nationalist ideology, the dream of a Turkey for the Turks. And this dream turned into a nightmare for the non-Turkish Christian minorities in the empire. Third point, under the circumstances of the ongoing war, this elite saw an opportunity, a cloak, and an ultimate rationale for launching a genocidal campaign against the Armenians. Blinded by their fears and suspicions of some Armenians, looking for revenge for the military humiliations they had had to endure, and guided, or maybe rather misguided, by their nationalist and Muslim hate fantasies, they decided to define all Armenians collectively as enemies and treat them accordingly. Although Turkish wartime allies, Germany and Austria, protested weakly, and Russia, France and England sent a stern and solemn warning to the Ottoman regime in May 1915, no power at the time was willing or able to intervene and effectively protect the Armenians from their horrible fate. One last remark. Those who deny the past will remain its prisoners, but those who acknowledge the past and honor its remembrance from time to time may set themselves free. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Zwaan, for your lecture. Normally, to digest what has been said, it would have been better to take some time off and to think through, but we don't have the time. I would like to ask you just shortly one or two questions.
Yes.
Looking back at this year's commemorations event, how do you look at the Dutch attitude towards the genocide? How do we deal with it in the Netherlands? What is our stand?
My impression is that we do not deal with it at all, at least officially. The Dutch government still is using the expression the Armenian question and now it has become the Armenian question of the genocide. The Dutch government, I'm not very proud of it, I must say, because they lack the courage and also the clarity to take a clear political and moral position. Nevertheless, among the German or the Dutch population, the knowledge about the Armenian genocide has grown. There have been quite some discussions, especially in the past 10 years, and I believe most Dutch people are more or less aware of what has been going on. So that would be my answer, very shortly.
Thank you. That's a clear answer. Just on Sunday, there were elections in Turkey, and looking at the election results, there are three new parliamentarians from Armenian descent.
Yes.
That's quite surprising. How do you look at that development? Does this...
Maybe, at least I hope so, it could be interpreted as a hopeful sign that minorities in Turkey, not only the Armenians, but also the Kurds and many other minorities, at least will get some representation in the Turkish parliament. And although Turkey is about, I believe now, 99% Muslim, and also the so-called White Turks, let me call it that, are dominating in the AKP and also in several other parties, I believe it's a step forward that at least three parliamentarians now have an Armenian background. Yes, yes.
All right, thank you. We have to continue in our program. And I would like to introduce the next guest, who is special musician, Levon Eskenian, composer, born in Lebanon 20 years ago, went back to Armenia, but traveled all around the world. One of the most active figures in Armenia's musical life. He is also the director of the Gurdjieff Folk Instrument Ensemble, that plays music of Armenian composers Gurdjieff and Komitas. And we'll talk later on about how they play it, because it's important to notice that it deals with music on authentic Armenian instruments. The ensemble received many awards, including the prestigious Edison Award. There are much more things to say about your work, Levon, but I'll have to keep it short, otherwise we will be busy until tomorrow with all the acclaimed successes you've had. I'm happy that you're here. You also performed in the Holland Festival in two different concerts. I would like to ask you to perform also for us, and later on I will ask a few questions to you, if that's okay.
Perhaps
you can also say something about the pieces you're going to play.
I will play Gurdjieff and Komitas, two pieces by Gurdjieff called Meditation and Orthodox Hymn for Midnight Service. Gurdjieff was a musician, spiritual leader, one of the most famous spiritual leaders of the 20th century. And two pieces by Komitas, two dances, Unabi and Marali. And as you know, Komitas is the pillar of the Armenian classical music. He traveled through different parts of Armenia and collected Armenian melodies, then composed pieces for the piano, vocal piano, and choir pieces. I will play them, we will talk about. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. to ask you, if you feel comfortable, you can sit there. You can also join me, because we will later on have a panel discussion with all our guests. You can already take a seat next to me. Yeah, that would be great if you can join me, because I have a few short questions. Later on, we will have the panel discussion, and I will ask more. But first of all, I want to ask a question that you shouldn't ask to an artist, not to a composer, but I'll have to do that. Is it possible to interpret? Is it possible to, when you look at music from Komitas, it's like a sacred person in Armenian history and music. What you do is you revive the legacy, and how do you revive it and put something in it of yourself? Yeah, you can take both of them. I think both of them are working. Yeah.
Yes, Komitas is sacred for Armenians, because it was through him a big part of our culture and music was preserved. Imagine how it would have been. He collected melodies from Garin, from Mush, which are now, there are almost no Armenians over there. And these parts were cradles of Armenian civilization. For millenniums, there were traditions built, and we played some of these pieces at Musik Hebau a few days ago. And these pieces are piano pieces, but Komitas mentioned on each of these pieces the sources, the instruments that he tried to imitate on the piano or wants the pianist to imitate those instruments. And beside all that, there is the history. For example, the Mshoshoror, which is a pilgrimage piece that the Armenians danced during their pilgrimage to St. Karabet Church in Mush, which was even a pre-Christian temple before 301. And each of these dances has traditions and the instruments that were born with. My work was to transcribe back to these instruments based on what Komitas mentioned.
And he mentioned it in detail, how the music should be played on which instrument.
Yes, he mentioned the performance styles, the instruments to be imitated, the characters, and he was so accurately working. That's why he was revising many, many times again to get the whole melodies, rhythms, and the soul of the music on Western instrument, through which it was much easier to introduce and promote this music in the West. That was one of his reasons that he started to arrange these pieces. But we got very original piano structure, very original piano pieces, because it was truly based on true, not imaginary folk music, folk music.
Real folk music. Would, in my opinion, you protect a form of heritage which otherwise would get lost, perhaps. And by doing so, also adding to the Armenian canon of art and history. Am I correct in that?
I'm just trying to be helpful to understand the interpretation, because these are piano pieces in the West. Sooner or later, it will be start to be played, because till now it wasn't published and wasn't spread. And they will be dealing with understanding what these styles are. It will be difficult in the West to understand what in the style of duduk and tar, in the style of daf and big percussion or zurna is. Yeah. So creating these sounds is one thing. Beside that, we are fortunate that through Komitas we had these pieces preserved through piano pieces, and bringing back to the original sounds, we revive this part of the culture. And also the history beside this music, it's not only music, and that is why he's sacred within the Armenians, because it's also traditions.
That is clear. I would like to think, and I would like to ask you, if you want to stay next to me, well, I'll call forward my next guest, and that is Tina Bastajian. Tina is born in Los Angeles. She is based in Amsterdam, and she is a film multimedia artist, essayist, researcher, teacher, archival dramaturg. Tina has also a resume that lasts 10 pages, but I will shorten it. She has exhibited in multiple festivals and galleries, took part in all kinds of symposia. In her work, she explores themes as fragmented memory, nostalgia, and absence. She uses the Armenian history and culture as a point of departure for her work. And one of her works we have selected, we will look at one of her films called Yagadakir. Jagadakir. I'll learn the Armenian language. Tonight I'll speak Armenian with everyone. We will look shortly at a fragment of your film, Tina. Would you like to introduce the film for us a bit before we have a look at it, or should we just plunge into it? Tina, what do you prefer?
I think I have to say a few words, yeah. But I think we're going to see the whole film, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know.
The film is 20 minutes, eh?
19.
19, all right. I have to be correct, 19.
And there's 19. three minutes of credits, because it's a low-budget film and you have to thank everyone very slowly, so be patient with the credits. It's the way it is. Do you have anything for me to introduce? I mean, did you want to ask me something first, or you want me to just plunge right in?
Yeah, perhaps we should plunge right in. That's even better, because then we get a notion of your work, and later on I've got some few difficult questions for you. So don't worry.
We'll just... Okay.
Yeah, we'll just... Can we start with the film? Is it possible to see it? Yeah?
Yeah.
Just turn it.
Երբ սուրճի քավաթը կգարտաս, քավաթը կթարցնես. It says, when you read a coffee cup, you turn it and then you open it. Հետո կփանաս և կգարտաս մրուրը կամ այն ինչ որ դագը մնացած է. You open it and you read the sediment, or whatever is left in the bottom. Թարգմանե այս մրուրը. Գարտա ինչ որ մնացածի.
Օֆսաննա Օֆսանա տունալ քիչիկ մմոդեցիր, քիչիկ մմոդեցիր հարությունին։ Գլուխը քիչ մա աչ Օֆսաննա։ Աբրես զակուկս, աբրես։
Cat, choose a category.
Near East trivia for 400, please.
Quoted in 1939, which infamous leader said, "Who still talks nowadays of the extermination of the Armenians?"
Yani o yere, ailenin ruhlar ağırlar vatanıdır. Sürgünlük kültürü dağılısı.
Thus foreshadowing his rise to power.
Uşadırıtıyon.
Hat?
Aha. Yegap.
Araksimor kurki derir peşinde vilayn lur daratskı. Urgu bahir vosgeğenler yev kalkmıkner. Pattıvats panvats latimı meç. Vor mayrıs jarankadir. Եվ որ մնալ ես պիտի ժառանգեի։ Կիդեր, անաբատներու լրությունը և ջիչը կեդերնի վար ձպացող ընդանիքներու։ Եվ հոդը պտտող երախաներու։
Սիրելի երախաներ, աստոր միթյունը ձեր որա ավորա։
Մեկ կարծի վրա ձերա։ Եթան
Pat, continue.
Near East Trivia for 900.
This small landlocked country, isolated by natural borders, seems a myth rather than a reality, so often changing its borders, which at its widest extent stretch from 37 to 40 east longitude and from 37 and a half to 41 and a half north latitude. Lee?
What is Uzbekistan?
No, sorry. Pat?
What is Georgia?
Sorry, no one got that one. The correct answer was Armenia. Correct. Pat, continue.
Near East Trivia for 400, please.
This Near Eastern country has continually refused to recognize what is referred to as the first genocide of the 20th century. Pat?
What is the Republic of Turkey?
Correct, Pat.
Near East for 500.
This term originates from the late 15th century, delineating the Near Eastern part of the Mediterranean with its islands and neighboring countries. Originally, a French term meaning literally rising up.
He was lucky they let her come. Then she came and she held her two kids' hand. Then one guy, after they kill all our mother, father, like for instance older sister, whatever, you know, uncles, my grandmother, everybody, you know. So then I'm sitting on the ground, like big area, you know. So all of a sudden I'm all alone, I'm crying, you know, I don't know where's my sister, Vashti, where's Auntie Ofsana, where's Auntie, my sister Alma. I was only by myself. Auntie Vashti took uncle. And then Aunt Alma take her children, and Auntie Ofsana, she was young that time too, and some Kurd, you know, those Arab, like main Arab and country, and he came and picked her up and took her on the horse, you know. There's no car there, it's all horses, you know. So, my gosh, I can't remember everything. Oh, see, this is like we sleep top of the roof.
Mm-hmm.
We all get, when summertime come, nobody sleep downstairs. I tell you one thing, this is our church, closer in our church, I think, this one here, you know? And this was closer to us, and we used to sleep towards this way. And when we used to lay down, and then, those Turkish people, they get up and there, they pray. Yeah, our town, this is Dikranagert, you know, our town. So then I'm sitting on the ground, like big area, you know.
Ase, inch vor ches gnar hishel. Patme, inch vor ches gnar hishel.
Anyway, then, when we were sitting before my father, mother, they took,
We were sitting like all around like this, for instance, and my mother took big yorga. You know yorga? It's not like our size. It was so huge. After that, they come and pulled that yorga, and they saw my sister, Lucia.
Birkaç sene Türkiye yolculuğumuzdan sonra bir yazmaya başladım. Türkiye etrafında hatıra, vatanlık, yer ve kalbi dönüşü. Zaten bir kitap Ararat Yolları yanımda vardı. Annemin hediyesi birkaç sene önce ve okumaya başladım. Yazarı bir konuşma anlatıyor. Türkiye'de Amerikan profesör ile Ermeni Kırım'ı etrafında. İnkar etmedi ama aynı zamanda itiraf da etmedi. Harikası küçüktü. Birbire bence geldi bir sözü. Niçin biz, nazik, Türk seven Amerikanlar, bizim Türkler bu felaket ile bulaşmayı istemiyoruz? Onun için sana özür dilemekliyim. Türkiye saatimizden zaman içliğini duymadın. Türkiye'ye gitmek için ne cesaretin lazımdır? Senin için tehlikeli vardı. Bedensel tehlikesi değildi. Ama ruhunu, canına tehlikesi vardı. Yani o yere ailenin ruhlar, ağırlar vatanıdır. Sürgünlük kültürü dağlısı. Bu ciddi şeyler o zaman da anlamadım. Pişmanım. Özür dilerim.
القطار السريع من القاهرة 235 المقرر سفرهم من تونس إلى سوسة فصفاقس في الساعة 11:13 سيتأخر نحو 30 دقيقة وعيد القطار السريع
Ան գսպասե վերազարտնելու մանգության գտնին։
Written on a person's forehead, one's fate, destiny, or luck. Lee?
Megner bego megner amber halale jan lale megner bego megner amber halale jan lale en inch bego tano bego halale jan lale en inch amber im yarite halale jan
Հորը բարաբ, երբեք քող չես, ուր որալ հաստատվիս։
بطبيعة الحال، أعطيك خريطة تأخذها معك. تمشي أولا إلى الأمام ثم تأخذ الشارع الثاني على اليمين إلى أن تصل إلى الإشارة الضوئية هنالك تتجه إلى اليسار. ثانية واحدة. نعم، إلى اليسار.
But anyway, so my mother, see, they were very smart. My mother made, like, for all of us, like, we couldn't have packages, you know. He made for us about 3-4 slip. We were 3 slip, 3 dresses, 3 this, wherever, you know. Then when we go, for instance, maybe something happened, you take that off the other one until we don't know where we're going to go, where we're going to do. They take us day and night. We walk and walk and walk, you know, until the time came when they came and they took it, they killed them. And after that, we all young people sitting there, each
she inch vor ches gnar asel
haram gerdich yete gareli duk asan kich m zakh dogi vran astetsek zavagat harutyun atokh zakh zerk dani ach usik vra yegav asank aha asank shat harmare Osana, Osana, tunal kich ma modetsur harutyunen, kich ma modetsur harutyunen, aha. Mikit zvart demkerov, zvart yerek. Shat lav nagarvi dilla, lusavor nagarvi dilla.
Armast mot yek ur aghchikis.
Lav e.
Kangnehos.
Ayo. Gadar lav gella yete du pokrikin yerekhan latselinum, anur hangstatsur, yes, almastin kchitken.
Almast lse, paron karapete inch kse.
Աղջիկս քիչ մասան։
Լավ է։
Լավ է ծակուկս։
Գեծես ծակուկս։ Այս նկարը շատ հիշարժան նկար պիտի լինի բոլորի համար։ Քիչիկ մզվարդ երեսներով եղեք։ Վստահ եմ Սուլթանն ալ պիտի ուրախանա այս նկարը տեսնելով, երեսներիդ նայելով։
Բայց ինչի՞ մենք պիտի ուրախ երևանք, եթե ուրախ չենք։
Լավ է բալիկս, երջանիկ եղեք։
Հիմա պատրաստվեք, գադար, եթե կարելի է քիչ մտու մոտեցիր, քիչ մը մոտեցիր։
Հոս լավ է, կողքին կկանգնեմ։
Քիչ մը մոտեցիր, օֆսանային մոտեցիր քիչ մը։ Հիմա նկարելու են, եթե կարելի անշարժ կեցեք, որպեսզի նկարը հաջող լինի։
Իրանք մեզ նկարի վրա կտեսնեն։
Այո, ծակուկս, պիտի հիշեն մեզ բոլորը։
Բայց ինչի մենք սառած մնանք։
Ծակուկս, կանգնի, չշարժվես, որ լավ դուրս գա նկարը։
Մահացած, պիտի երևանք։
Հիմա սև կլա, աղջիկս, վերջը նկարը լուսավոր կլա։ Հիմա նայեք ձախ ձեռքիս։ Անշարժ կեցեք, շադիր, նայեք ձախ ձեռքիս, մեկ վարկյան, ահա, եղավ։
Աչկեիս մեր լույսեր կերևան։
Երեք փեշ և օժիդի ոսկի աբարանչաններ, գծպան մերած գիներու նման եպրատ մի վար։ Եվ գնգղմին մորքուրներու ստգած ոսպի հատիկներու նման որև է կարտեսի վրա չէ իսկական վայրեր երբեք չեն զար
Yeah, that's the very last. And then from my childhood dancing in sort of this last life.
I loved it how you deal with all these bits and pieces of memory, thoughts, ideas, images that are blurred sometimes, like it is in our memory. How do you, that you try to weave them into a film? Then I'll get to my first question. How do you deal with the blank spots in your memory? As an artist, you try to reconstruct a part of your memory, and this memory is filled with blank spots.
Well, it's not just my memory. It's memory. It's memories or oral histories, let's say, in particular. Not necessarily this whole film is based on oral history, but when listening to oral history, and what you heard was my grandmother, she it was in bits and pieces. I kept trying to get her to make sense of like a beginning, middle, and end. Well, it was all middles and more middles and more fragments. And so I thought it would come.
Will there ever be an end? Is it ever possible to get that to an end?
No, but that's the fun part. You can keep reweaving it. Yeah.
Reweaving over.
Those themes come back in other ways. I mean, yeah. I mean, might not have the same thematic, but certain threads come back, for sure.
There are also lots of symbols. Huh? Most of the time, if you don't have an Armenian background, you might perhaps not recognize it, but anyone who has ever been to Armenia or has Armenian friends knows if they see a pomegranate, for instance, immediately pops up the symbolic meaning of a pomegranate or other images.
In particular the pomegranate.
Can you tell for
but
perhaps
many of those symbols aren't really Armenian? I mean, you know, I'm playing with also this hybrid notion of also images of, watermelon. Why watermelon? Watermelon was grown where my grandparents' family is from, was Diyarbakir, and it was known to have some of the biggest watermelons in the world. Kids could sit in them and play inside the watermelon. So it was this image and always telling the kind of these very strange anecdotes about watermelon. Also, watermelon was really big in this. I used to think watermelon was only for Armenians. I mean, this is what you thought. And then your African-American friends were like, yeah, we eat watermelon too.
I was
like,
oh, right,
we got something in common. Okay, that's great. So, I mean, a lot of them are really
Of course, you weave all these places, all these cities where you've lived and memories together and sometimes provide them with an existing meaning, but sometimes there's also a lack, a physical breakdown, like we see in a film. Is that the moment where you can't give it a meaning or a place?
The breakdown.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes there's a rough cut, like we say in film.
I think those rough cuts add to something else. I mean, they kind of give a tempo or a texture to the film. I mean, if you just think about it filmically, but I'm not answering your question.
No, you're answering fine, but we already started in a discussion. Well, the idea was to give a short impression of your work and then later on have a talk. So perhaps we should keep that one for later on in the program. Then I will invite my third guest to come and present his work. Krikor Momdjian, a visual artist also, but also a poet. He is also born in Lebanon, but lives in the Netherlands right now for already 30 years. And this identity, this actually tree-structured identity from Lebanon, the Netherlands, and Armenia, plays a pivotal role in his creation of work through which he seeks and expresses his own cultural identity and authenticity. When we had this pre-talk, Krikor, you said to me, before we go into anything, I just want to come up with a poem. I want to start with a poem, and I really love that. That an artist is, to me, someone who expresses himself, herself in various ways in which they choose to at that certain moment. You chose to express yourself, to start off with a poem. So I think that would be a good idea to start off with that poem and then later on look at your visual work. Is that all right?
You hear me?
Yes, all right.
Thank you. Parirego. Parirgun. Later on I will tell you why twice. Goedenavond. Welcome. I wrote a poem yesterday night, especially for you. That's why I thought this morning, perhaps I have to start with it. You know, you're an artist. You don't sit to write a poem. The poem comes to you. So, this poem is for you. The title is Thinking of You. From here to far away places, I have only precious wishes for you. Speaking of remembrance, I am thinking of you. In this darkness, I cannot see you all, but I know you are there. I remember well, because I have seen all your faces before. In the shadows of the pomegranate trees, I have heard your voices. I have heard your whisperings from eternity. Yes, my friends, I miss them all. I can go on like this the whole evening, the whole night, telling you thousands of stories until you fall down to deep sleep. But you will wake up, and I'm sure you will wake up with a new energy, I just wrote it this evening, that's why. With a new energy, with new twinkling eyes, you will be looking at a new horizon far. I wished we were together, listening to the wind. Remember, I will always be thinking and waiting for you. This poem is for you.
Thank you, Krikor.
Where shall I sit here?
Yeah? Wherever you want, because you wanted to...
Oh, yes, sure.
...give a short presentation about the work. Am I allowed to ask you a couple of questions while we look at the images?
Yes.
Instead of afterwards. But before you go to that first image, let's get back to the poem. What is the language of your heart? You speak multiple languages.
Yes.
You wrote this one in English?
Or I wrote it in English because we have to speak in English, I presumed. So, gladly, I'm blessed that in Lebanon we were educated in four languages at the same level. As Armenians, I was in an Armenian school, so we had to learn everything in Armenian. Next, Arabic, because you couldn't go to university if your Arabic was not good. And, or French or English. I was educated in an English school. The main language was English.
French was second, third language. But in the lower school, I had French because I was at the Militarist school. They were very severe, so my French was good.
Deeper.
When I went to Paris...
What is the language of your heart when you write poems?
You know, I would, if I say it is Armenian, I would not lie at all, because it is your mother tongue. You are born with that language. So I will read to you one at the end in Armenian.
Okay.
You will see...
Yeah, because I want to see the difference. What happens if you read it in Armenian?
I will get emotional and very to the heart. And the use of the words are my heritage from the Armenian poets.
Yeah.
So that is a kind of tradition you try to continue.
Yep.
Okay. But when I write in English, well, I am more practical, perhaps. But here you see that I was very emotional. I thought, today you will not be emotional because of the subject, but you hear in my voice that it touches me in that sense, that we are all one.
That's true. Krikor, let's look at some of your work, and perhaps we can go through them, because you're a visual artist.
Yes. I wanted to start with this work, which has nothing to do with genocide, to give you an idea how I function as a person and as an artist, how I think. This is in 1991. Actually, we were the first artists in Holland to discuss this multicultural society, how we deal with the other. So, we were couples. Actually, this project was called Double Dutch. So they found one from, all of them are Dutch from nationality, like me, but from another cultural background. I was Armenian, the other one from Israel, mm-hmm. Turkey. Well, we had to make one work. So I said to Marius, let us make one piece of art that they shouldn't know what you did and what I did. So at a certain moment it was difficult because, you know, the artists, they try to convince the other one. At the end, he said, no, Krikor, I like your idea. Let's do it. So I said, let's put a table in the middle of a room. This is an installation. That means the room is a piece, is a part of the piece. So I'll be short. The table is a metaphor for a place where we meet, we discuss, and those dishes, they are sculptures, as if people sit with their own cultural identities and they try to communicate with their neighbors. That's the way we have to find a solution for a coexistence in a harmonious way. And this blue light is actually symbolic for the divine, which unites us. Coming to our subject of tonight, I have done several works. This one is dedicated, as Dr. Zwaan said, for the intellectuals who were captured on 24th of April in Istanbul. So I was thinking of them. So I was trying through my own identity when I started the portrait series with the question, who am I? What is my own identity? I have studied in Paris, in Italy, in the United States, in Lebanon. Who I am? And as following, I did this one for the as commemoration or thinking about the intellectuals who died. I called it Golgotha, and I miss them all. When you look at this picture, well, I use open book as metaphor in my work, and I tell story. And on the left hand, you have a document, what happened. And on the right hand, you have a question mark of the artist who is in a quest, who wants answers, who searches for the reason. How is it possible that a human being can do such an act, barbaric act? Well, you see, 100 years ago it happened, and now it is happening too, in the same region, the same atrocities. So I'll come to Komidas. We heard his music. I wonder, Komidas. So I made, long time ago, dedicated to Komidas a series. Unfortunately, this is not very bright in colors. You see him as a priest. He was a priest composer, actually. Levon has told about his heritage, his legacy for the Armenian people. He went in the nature. He listened not only to the people to get out, to take the authentic music of all the nations, actually, Armenians, Turks, Kurds, and he wanted to get out the real Armenian spirit of it. So I see him here as a person who is one with the nature. He's listening to the nature. In his music, you can, this is also one of recent works. The other one is very old, but this one is also inspired of one of his songs, Karuna. It is a spring, but it is a snowing. So the melancholic side of the music, but at the same time, I tried here with the four pomegranates to show the beauty of the nature, which comes back. And we eat those fruits. We know the symbolical idea of them, of revival, actually. And the light of the nature, I emphasize in this work. And technically, I use all the materials, all the techniques I need to make a piece of art. It can be an etching, it can be sculpture, it can be a painting. This is a digital painting. A very personal story I have to tell about this one. It is a document, actually. When I came to Holland 35 years ago from Paris with love, because my wife is Dutch, I fell in love with this flat nature of Holland, Polderlandschap. Many Dutch people find it very boring. I found it, on the contrary, very inspiring, because I could see for the first time the horizon. So my mind could travel far. This is the look from my studio, my house, to the village, Waalbrugge. So I thought, 22 years later, I made one piece, this one. I'm very proud that the Museum of Lucknow, when the director saw this work in Atelier Amicitie in Amsterdam here, there was an exhibition, Holland Landschap. I had sent this work. She saw it. She called me. You don't sell that work. I have an option. I have to discuss with my staff. But I said, this work is not the only one. It is a trilogy. There's another one and a sculpture. And I will talk about it later. These are the three pieces, the two paintings and the sculpture in the middle. So they came and they liked it. They said, this is your story. So I'm very grateful they have it. I will read to you this poem. I wrote the poem in Armenian very emotionally when I made this painting. But I put on this Dutch landscape Ararat, the Mount Ararat, as if I was missing something essential in this landscape. That's my background. But the relation is for me actually to show my harmonious, very happy existence. In Armenian, I will say the first one, Arduye Virigun, Tranes Archev, Antataran Verch, Amberet Papuk, Yerker Gusen, Horke Tsustalov, Amen Ansorti, Amen Bantuchti. Night and day, out of my door, ceaselessly, endlessly, new songs weave your clouds soft, revealing your depth to every passerby, to every wanderer. Night and day is your image that I always see. As soon as I open my eyes, it is your light that enters. Now in my veins, my blood stirs, my heart is lifted. Only by seeing you it is that my spirit soars. My day begins radiant with hope. And as if I missed the second part of the story. That's why I called this trilogy Golden Dinner, Broken Dreams. Broken Dreams is this one. This is actually my father on his white horse in Lebanon, in the mountains. This man came as an orphan to Lebanon. He was brought as orphan, my mother also. He came from Yozgat, my mother from Diyarbakir, Tikranagert. They built a new future for us. That's why I am very grateful as an artist. It was my duty to honor them. Later on, you will see my mother. But now, this one, this, if I don't say this is my father, he's an Armenian, nobody would guess. Because you see in Arabic blood, horse. This horse, he said to me, my father said, I couldn't see them because when I was born, they were already gone. He said, I could talk with these two horses. He had two of them. They were like human beings. He was a very brave man. When you see him with his European costumes, you don't know, is he European? With the fez, Ottoman, is he Turkish? Well, this is a part of the story of the trilogy. I will finish my talk with this. When I was writing a book, there was a chapter about my mother, because I went specially a week to Drenthe to write. I was in the kitchen. You won't believe me. I felt the presence of my mother. I was making my lunch. That night, I went home and I started painting her portrait. Because she was, you would say, everybody's mother is dear for everybody, but she was the pillar of our home. She has taken care that all the children, grandchildren, they could get the love they needed to build their own futures. Everybody is scattered now in Canada, America, everywhere. They are very happy in Boston and Toronto. So, but she had one longing. She said, I hope there is paradise And God has a place for us because we suffered in this life. So I made this second painting, The World in Light. That's her longing. If you permit me, I will finish one poem I wrote to my mother. And actually, then you will see it was written in Armenian. We translated it in Oxford because we have a project there with Professor von der Lind. They are translating, his students are translating my Armenian poems into English. So it was difficult to say Mayrim. How can you translate mother? Mom, mommy, my sweet mother. At the end, my sweet mother. I think also not only about mother, the mother nature. That's my intention. My sweet mother, you are the sweet taste of my childhood memories. Royal radiant fruit, bright like the rays of the sun. Mother, you are the delight of my heart. The mystery of life embodied within you, you are the refraction of my dreams. On your radiant face, a human's love for another human being shines. Mother, you are balsam for my soul. A many-hued symbol of universal love, you are the bright star of my heaven. Giving purpose to my life, you are the source of inspiration for my love. My sweet mother, keeping alive in me the spirit of God, you are my daily prayer. Thank you.
Thank you, Krikor. I would like you to sit next to me, and I would like to ask Levon and Tina also to join me here at the table.
Thank you.
Oh, sit here. Krikor, looking at your work, there are a few things that struck me. When we saw this view on Wout Brugge,
yes,
with the Armenian poem written on it. It is partly that you put your Armenian heritage also in a Dutch landscape, that you are visible part of the Dutch landscape. You put elements of the past inside this flat land of Wout Brugge. What is the part you take from the Netherlands, because you are here for 30 years, huh?
35 years.
There is this part of the Netherlands, this inside of you, and part of Armenia that you put inside of the Netherlands, huh? It's a way of negotiating yourself within this environment. Can I say it like that?
Yes, I am integrating, actually, the two. For me, it's a whole, one. I don't see it as separate. My Armenian identity is me. I am also Dutch, because it came later, but I function as a Dutch artist. All my colleagues are Dutch. You have seen the first one.
Yes.
But you cannot produce a fictive, another a work of art which is not related
to yourself,
to your life. I wanted to say also that remembrance for me is directly related to life experience.
Talking about that remembrance, eh? Let's take one of the elements that in the work Golgotha.
Yes.
Golgotha refers to a period in time in which the Armenian intellectual elite was massacred. Huh? You try not to forget what has happened. You try to protect that history. Do you see it as a task for every Armenian intellectual to
protect that legacy? Certainly. Not only to protect, I mean, you have inherited something. You are obliged to give it, to pass it to the second, other generations. Not only Armenians. I mean, your culture is universal. Art is a language which I believe is universal.
That is true, but there's a bigger burden, that's my feeling, and correct me if I'm wrong, when it comes to Armenian artists. I've dealt with lots of artists, but the burden of history seems much bigger when it comes to Armenian artists. Is it possible, perhaps I'll ask the question to Tina. Tina was thinking, please do not ask me that question.
Is it so obvious? Is it true?
Is it possible to avoid certain parts of that history? Because the art world is framing all the time artists in a certain way, with a focus on history. Is it possible as an artist to ever escape from that framing?
Yeah, it's difficult. I mean, especially we have an evening like tonight.
Yeah, because you're framed again tonight as Armenian artist.
Yeah, it happens invariably, but obviously there are exceptions. And as time has gone on, work, let's say my work has been integrated into other sort of types of programming where it takes up themes or stylistics, aesthetics, etc., of different works from different regions, and maybe it's not all identity based. So yeah, we are always kind of,
because there is a shift. Is that what you?
I think there's a bit of a shift. Yeah,
there's a bit
but
of
now
a shift.
With, you know, when you have the 100-year commemoration, I mean, even I made this film in 2001, so there was this kind of whole 90-year. It was just after the 90-year, so this kind of these decades that go, these kind of markers, you know? Yeah. So it was kind of, at the time, yeah.
No, I totally understand. I just want to hear your opinion on that, because on one hand, an artist can see it as a task to protect a part of the history, not only protect, but also to build a legacy or to continue on a legacy like what Levon is doing. But on the other hand, I can imagine that it's quite difficult to have this topic getting back at you as an artist, because an artist tries to find a universal voice. Yeah? Out of that personal experience, turn that into a universal voice. Or is it just my observation when I'm asking this?
Yeah, I totally agree. But also there's another layer of burden. I mean, there's this burden of history that one has to, that you're obliged to represent, let's say, a community, a nation, et cetera, et cetera. And we all come from different parts and had different experiences, obviously. Are multilingual, some people are only monolingual. But the burden of just, it's like a phantom, let's put it that way, in terms of, I'm not saying it's in a bad phantom, because I use phantom as a metaphor in a lot of my work, or apparition, let's say, these kind of apparitions, but sometimes it's to play with them in a way that, I mean, to transcend is a big word, but I mean, it's not to forget, but I must say that there is something about forgetting that's healthy. And that maybe seems like, oh my God, I shouldn't say that. But I remember there was one a speaker, I don't know, a book or an article saying something like, Armenians could do a little bit more forgetting and Turks could do with a little bit more of remembering. and I thought there's something to that. But there, like, you know, in the film, it's like there's some kind of undoing of trying to undo some of this, you know, and so I'm struggling with that, but it's also part of my repertoire.
That's a good summary of your work. It's part of your repertoire, indeed, this struggle. Is there a difference how artists who live outside Armenia deal with this issue and artists living inside Armenia. Perhaps, can I ask you that, Levon, because you are the only one who is right now based in Armenia.
Well, the Armenian diaspora counts around more than 8-9 million Armenians, and we mechanically or consciously, subconsciously, we live this history. We are grandchildren of survivors. I am also, because my grandparents, part of them, were orphaned, and I've always heard these stories. And I was born in Lebanon because of this, and all of the diaspora Armenians and the artists in the diaspora, they know why they are born outside. And naturally, their art will bear this. In Armenia, they, of course, there are so many Armenians that also are grandchildren of survivors, because many escaped to Armenia at the time, or they immigrated back in the 1960s and 40s. But again, the perception sometimes is different, because we are still living outside, and they Armenians that are born in Armenia, they are or on their homeland.
Because for the one who is born outside and has not returned, the homeland has become sometimes a utopic ideal. Sometimes it's a place which is only imaginative.
Yes. Yes, yes, it is. But in general, for all Armenians, it is a wound which is not yet cured, and it needs a cure. As long as it's open, it can't be forgotten. There are pages in Armenian history. It's been 1,500 years that we commemorate. And I think this is a very, very big part of our history.
Yeah.
And we are still living it. As long as we are living it, we can't say that it can be forgotten by pressing it. It needs a cure.
It needs a cure, and a cure might be that the world recognizes the genocide. Is that a form of cure? Because that is also mentioned by lots of writers and scholars, that when the world starts to recognize the genocide, a lot of people can finally digest it themselves.
Yes, but this is not something when we say the world recognizes, by recognizing everything can be cured, things should be done to not be repeated again. And unfortunately, we are living these historical horrible things again after all these years, in the same, as Krikor said, in the same regions. It's being repeated. Why things are repeated? Because
you mentioned the killings of by East Daesh and all the other crooks right now. Yeah,
it is again a genocide, because men and women and children are being killed. Why should it be? Things should be done, that history should be well explained, explored. In Turkey, there's people should know the history, what has happened, and should not be afraid of talking about. And through time, we can then, I think really by traveling there, I haven't been there. I would love to be in Kutahya, in Kutina, in Aintab, where my grandparents were. Actually, from my mother's side, even we are relatives of Komidas. I would love to see those places. But I've never felt that I'm ready yet to go.
That is clear and also painful to hear that. How do you look at that?
Yes, I think here you have to add one practical notion of education, because to change the attitudes of people, I think education plays a very important role. And in Turkey and everywhere, they have to educate people, telling what has happened. Remembrance is a part of it. I mean, I just said also that remembrance is related to experiences in life. And you remember, just how Levon said, just to not repeat, to learn from the past. That's why we remember, we have to remember. But education is important. You have to give the exact education to the people so that people can take part to that evolution of acceptance and also conciliation. It cannot happen just like that.
You mentioned the word reconciliation. Can you elaborate a bit? What do you mean with that reconciliation?
I mean, if you very simply said, what happened as genocide is blocking these two nations to be friends. They are neighbors. They have always, centuries, they lived together. Armenians lived in Turkey. Why they should be afraid? I think there's another element. Religion plays an important role in it, that fanatism. And if they try to solve that problem and say, okay, we have to accept the religion of the other, and then it is not simple. You see now what's happening now. It's as if we go back 100 years back.
No, that's
the same atrocities are happening now. What can we do? What are we doing?
As artists, the only thing you can do is make beautiful artistic works reflecting on what you feel and what you think, and that's what the three of you are already doing. I would like to continue a bit more on the artistic work, because sometimes that's the reason why I ask, do you feel it as a burden that you feel this representation or the urge to talk about the genocide or to integrate it inside your work? On the other hand, I understand that it can be a choice as well for an artist mm-hmm. to claim that part of your history and to deal with that in your artistic work. I can totally understand that.
We have to use one word here, which we didn't, being uprooted.
Uprooted?
Yes, that you have lost your roots. We diaspora, Armenians, we have lost that link with the land. It is cut. But Armenians living in Armenia, they don't feel that. They don't have that problem. Armenians born in Armenia, mother Armenia, highlands. But we, from Anatolia, historical Armenia, everybody's gone. And we are the third generation, fourth generation, so they will assimilate at a certain moment. But for me, having
standstill
the,
means
the education.
So you have to resist. Interrupted you. You talked about assimilation. I understand what you're saying about
the risk.
Loss of a history. If you don't deal with that notion, you will be erased. That's what you're trying to say? Or?
Yes, certainly. If the Armenians in the diaspora, they don't build quickly a school, educate, give the culture to the new generations,
they will be assimilated. Let's try to get back to the autistic work. Levon, I would like to ask you about when we started to talk about your work, I said something like, you claim a part of history, you claim, and then you get into a notion of authenticity, huh? Trying to get the authentic music and with the authentic instruments. That part is clear, but the part of the Armenian history was oral tradition. The music was never written on pieces of paper. Is that part lost, or are you also busy with trying to protect that part of Armenian culture as well?
Well, the folk music was orally transmitted, but church music was written from 9th century. So, according to Komidas, Armenian sacred church music was based on folk music, and these were brothers and sisters. And Armenian church music, naturally folk music, goes back to before Armenia's Christianity, adopting the Christianity, which is 301. So we go back to millenniums.
Yes.
And yesterday we were also playing in Brussels, and I had this idea over there that in Europe there should be concert series of ancient music. Not only by saying ancient music we should understand pre-Baroque or Baroque European music, but ancient music from different parts of the world. And this music, which is ancient, which is the heritage of the whole humanity, and it should be heard. It was orally transmitted and mostly intact, because they were living in the same place for centuries and keeping the tradition. And fortunately, at the time when Govindas was collecting this, it was the, you know,
flourishing.
Yes,
flourishing period.
Flourishment of the this culture. So, and also comparing with Armenian church music, which was written, you can see that it was kept intact for centuries. Mm-hmm. We have part of this culture, Western Armenian culture, which now the Armenian diasporans living outside are year by year maybe losing it. We are fortunate that in music we had many of these written by Gomidas and defined. He defined this, was able to define, because he had an education in Western classical music and also in Armenian traditions and also Asian and Turkish music, Kurdish music. He analyzed and was able to define the archaic, specifics of Armenian music. What is it? And we have this obligation as an artist to share it with the world, something of world heritage culture, which is not very well, still very well known in the West. And beside it, by reviving it, we are bringing back what we had and what could be, what we can lose it, what we have, and what chances do we have in these days to revive. Tomorrow we might not be able to remember even many parts of this. So that's what I believe in, and I'm putting most of my energy last years to do that, to be part of that.
Okay, lovely. You said about belief and about the future, about tomorrow. Tina, I would like to ask you,
if you look at the future, do you as an artist have to create image for an imaginative future? Are you busy with that, to create new images or new meanings when it comes to issues of identity?
To create a new future, you're saying.
Yep.
Yeah. I think...
It's almost 10 o'clock, so
I think, right. Well, just briefly, I think it's also about, this imaginary, this speculation of what if you're talking about in terms of Armenian-ness or Armenian identity, to expand upon that and to break out of sort of the molds and the kind of cookie-cutter genres and stereotypes, characteristics, tropes that get repeated and repeated. And, for me, it's to actually explore a lot of things in Turkey and to with different people within Turkey. And it could be Armenia, it could be anywhere. I've done a few projects there. And to me, that sort of opens up dialogue. I mean, it opens up a space
dialogue.
Yeah, dialogue, or new. I mean, it doesn't have to be about this issue in particular. Yeah. I mean, it could be about nature.
Yeah, of course.
It could be about coffee. It could be whatever.
If coffee predicts the future.
Yeah,
also,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah, so coffee comes back in all my projects.
Coffee
comes back. Yeah.
Before we round it up, I would like to look at the audience. If there are people who feel the need to ask questions for the guests, perhaps we can take a few questions with us before we round up, because we have to keep it short. But are there any questions? They're in the back.
My name is Typhoon. When I was listening to your piano play, it was felt really like European, not really Armenian. And when I saw your film, I could see something familiar. I'm Turkish, and it was as if my parents were dancing in the middle in America.
They were.
Yeah, it was. So. What is more authentic? Because we talked about authentic Armenian things. So which one is authentic? Because if I see the piano, I see Atatürk, and he also enforced piano music to the Turkish public. But it sounds fake.
Do you feel the need to react on what about authenticity? What is Armenian about what we just heard? That's what he is asking.
Authenticity is the soul. If we hear the music of Komitas on the piano, piano is a language to express the soul. I am thinking now I'm Armenian, I'm talking English, but I'm Armenian. And it's the same with this music on the piano, which he did to be able at the time to present this music in a Western phase, to be able to spread. What I'm doing is bringing back to the instruments that he encountered and mentioned on each of the pieces to imitate, and by bringing back, you will get the authentic, the soul and the language that we heard at Musique about a few days ago. But this is, for that time, it was practical. But the soul is there, I think.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions? No, you can return with the mic. let me ask a few more questions, and then we round it up, because we can also continue our talks later on at the bar with all the guests, and perhaps in a more cheerful setting. I want to know a bit about the future plans of you as artist. Krikor, starting with you, what kind of work are you going to do? You are going to Oxford, that's what you said?
Yes, we started already a year ago. Next year we'll end it at the end with an exhibition of my works as painter. I'll make also an installation and a film. And my Armenian poems, translated into English, will be published. So at the university, in Pembroke College, we'll present the book and the exhibition in the same building of the university. That's one of the main projects I'm busy with now.
Okay.
But it's also nice to hear this. Now there is an exhibition in Gouda, in museum, group exhibition. We had to send one work. I sent landscape, similar to what you saw, Friesland. The title is also Friesland. Ik hou van Holland. It is really 1.50 meters by 1.10, very still landscape. They will ask questions. Why Krikor is presenting now Dutch landscapes, very still?
Is Arafat in it?
Ararat, no. Ararat, no. Arafat. Yes, no. No, it is real
it's
Dutch.
A Freudian
it is actually,
of the
yes, it's actually, I'm giving back to Holland what Holland gave to me in this work. But in it, there are other question marks. I left 5 centimeter blank, white. So the painting, it is as if as a collage, you would think. No, it is painted, but it stops somewhere. So it is more a question of what are you looking at? Nature, the beauty goes away. So you have to live your life. That is the clue.
Okay, thanks. Tina, Armenian artists are now right now peaking in Venice at the Venice Biennial. The Armenian Pavilion won the Golden Lion as best pavilion. 14 Armenian artists from the diaspora have participated in that. There is lots of attention for Armenian artists. How do you look at that development?
Well, I think the curatorial vision is quite strong. I haven't been there to see the show, but in terms of it's getting a lot of attention, it's getting a lot of press, and people are starting to dig a little bit deeper on what are some of this iconography or what are these themes that maybe aren't just on the surface that one might usually talk about, to go a little bit deeper from the articles that I've read. So yeah, it's getting a tremendous amount of press.
And did it get that amount of press and the reward as a form of gesture?
Because of the 100 years?
Yeah. Do you think that played a role?
One day I might say yes, one day I might say no. I don't know. I need to see the show first.
Yeah, I know. I know half of the artists, and they're really good.
Yeah,
so I can say that they're really good. That's in artistic sense. But I just wanted to hear your...
That's a tricky question.
Yeah.
Well, it makes a powerful statement now, doesn't it? You know, Armenian Pavilion by diasporan artists wins the Golden Lion. Yeah. With other very illustrious artists alongside, like Adrian Piper, and I forgot who else won. So, I mean, it puts on this platform.
And at a special spot, of course, in Venice, because it's an old Armenian monastery. Where there is also print press. And
it's another placing on the map, actually.
Yeah. but also to cherish a part of that intellectual future again.
Yeah.
By Armenians who are living outside of Armenia. Levon, also for you, thanks that you participated, and we had the chance to see you in Muziekgebouw, but also in a charming smaller place called Podium Mosaic. I'm coincidentally also a member of the board of Podium Mosaic, so happy to have you there. What are the future plans from now on with your music? What are the challenges?
This program we just started, actually it was the first concert in Europe with this new program. So it's newly starting. We have recorded a recording on ECM that will be soon produced on two records, one with the authentic instruments in September, and next year the piano pieces of these same pieces, the original form that we have by Komidas, his compositions, so the same pieces within 6 months of period. Then we will start performing concerts in Europe more constantly. That's one thing. But again, we will continue the researches and get more deep into. There's a lot of music which is not being read yet because many of the Armenian church music is written in Armenian noims, the Khaz is called. There's a lot to be done for comparing with ancient Byzantine chants and other noims to be able to have the keys of reading these thousands of melodies. So there's a lot to be done, and mainly it will be a work on Armenian music.
Yeah.
And of course, to do that, you need to do researches in all the ancient music that Armenian music had or had influences on it, or it had influences on other cultures.
Okay. All right, I would like to thank you all. There is only one small thing. I've got a small present for you. I took that along. Yeah, now you're curious, just for your participation, but it's a small presence. I hope you will enjoy this. This is for you.
Oh, thank you.
This is for you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I know it's not the season right now, so it might be that they are really sour a bit. So I wouldn't. You can break it. You can throw it inside the audience, and perhaps yes. it will bring luck to some of the younger people here to get married or whatever.
I will paint it first.
Okay. I would like to thank you all for joining us and sharing thank your you. Ideas with us. And I would like to thank the audience that you've stayed and participated and listened. So give them a big round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you.
Professor Dr. Zwaan and the Holland Festival.
Een soort van bevestiging. Waarom is het dan zo? zo interessant om dit te doen, om dit deze schrift te schrijven over Doe maar dan? Laat ik het zo vragen.
Ja, omdat de Beatles inderdaad het voorbeeld van de grootste buitenlandse band, de grootste bandsband. En Doe maar staat over het algemeen in Nederland echt bekend als de grootste band. En heel veel muziekcritici zeggen ook, er is sinds Doe maar echt nooit meer zoiets gebeurd in Nederland. En daarom vond ik het